Hey, good morning. Hey,
Hello, hello.
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 Hello. Cool, should we get started? I'll do the regular spiel. Hey everyone, this is the GUAC maintenance meeting. This openness meeting is in accordance with the Linux Foundation and OpenSSF Code of Conduct, and also antitrust policies. For more information, please take a look at the OpenSSF/LF website. In addition, this meeting is being recorded and will be accessible online. Cool. All right. Let's put in items that we want to talk about today. I'll give it another minute to that. Folks are still typing, so. Cool. Right, no, middle true. I think it's all friendly people that we know, so no new friends. Cool. I think let's dive right in then. The first one I added, this was I started doing the dev, so dev on I think we call it like the scan on ingestion. I think a couple of things I noticed going through this. I'll talk about the observations and then I'll kind of talk a little bit about a decision point that we need to make. I think a couple of observations I had was that the depth of depth collector, I think, wasn't updated to use the new SBOM format, so it didn't have like its dependencies within the SBOM. There is SBOM. Also, I don't know whether that's automatic.
What do you mean by that?
So like when you create a is SBOM, I think we updated it so that every occurrence and every is dependency that is part of the S bomb will be referenced within the S bomb.
It's not doing that?
I don't think so. Or maybe it's handled somewhere that I didn't see. I was
there
looking
a has.
At the test. Yeah, let's look at this thing. So it has the ingest predicates, its dependencies, has source at. I think the has sbom. We don't have the
includes, you mean?
New fields, yeah, the new fields that we added in here. Right. But that got me also thinking, is like, do we? I don't know. At least for the on the ingestion one, I'm not sure whether it makes that much sense to put it in. Which kind of leads to the second point I wanted, my second observation, which was like, this will create code drift. Both in the Perl stuff that we're doing and the license stuff that we're doing, but also like this one, right? Like, I was trying to look at it in terms of code reusability, but I think the collector has a lot more setup and a lot more involved steps that we don't necessarily want in the ingester. So yeah, I think that was my two observations of this. This could just be like a bug, like someone who just created a bug to say like, so we should implement, we should integrate the new fields and has a spawn.
So I think it's there. It's
oh, is
done
that?
At, I think it's done at the,
the ingestion time.
Yes.
Okay. Interesting. Well,
yes, I think it's being done here. SS bomb package IDs. Yeah. Yep.
Okay.
It's being done on bulk. On you know, if you go to assembler clients helper bulk.
Okay.
Assembler. So it's what it does is that when it ingests like all these packages, clients, yeah, bulk, and then here it's aggregating all the packages, aggregating all the dependencies, aggregating all the artifacts and all the occurrences. And it's passing that to the has sbom on ingestion.
Gotcha.
Yep.
Gotcha.
So yeah, that's... I was like, I'm pretty sure it's doing it right. I was like,
okay,
because we're doing the same thing for Cyclone DX and XPDX. I was like, it should all be
okay.
The same.
That's interesting because that means you can't ingest more than one sbom per ingest predicate, right?
Ingest predicate,
because you're associating the is dependency predicates with this the has s bomb, right? Wait, where is it? Collected artifacts. Wait, let me make this bigger. You're kind of collecting the ID of artifacts here, right? You ingest artifacts here. And then I'm assuming here dependencies is somewhere. Its dependency ID is here, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Now, if you have two SBOMs, where's the has SBOMs? So ingest has S.
But there can never be multiple SBOMs for ingestion.
I think that's the interesting part, right? Because technically, it's a this. Oh no, it's not.
It's
Maybe I miss saw that. Okay. I mean then it's fine if it's
There should never be multiple S bumps unless you saw multiple has S bumps.
Yeah. That's why I'm wondering, like, in this case, should we change that? Like, I guess we should change the interface to not be a list, right?
Yeah, I mean, yeah, technically it's never going to be a list.
But I think what we're saying is it can't be a list.
Nope.
Okay. So we should add a.
Let me see. And
create an issue on this. Does that make sense, I guess? We should just change this to a singleton.
I think so. I gotta look at the thing to see.
Yeah, but you can see
Interesting.
how this may be
Yeah.
confusing, right? Then it changes the semantic where these things are not
Yeah, you're
necessarily.
right. Yeah. Yeah, it can't be.
Yeah.
Ingest has S bomb ingest can only be a single singleton. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're right. So yeah, we can change that. That makes sense.
Yeah, but I'm wondering because like the way we do it is like, oh, we pass the artifact stuff, ingest it, and so technically like technically if we wanted to do it right, we would say, okay, like all these things are hashable into something and then the has SBOM included. Yeah, but I don't think we gotta deal with that now, so it's
Well, includes is only the IDs, right?
yes.
So that's why it's done at the, because we have to ingest it first, figure out what the IDs are, and then you can associate it with the SBOM.
I think we just have to be clear with what the contract of ingest predicates is, because I think the initial contract of ingest predicates is like everything's just like different predicates and you just take them in and put them through. We never
Which is
had,
fine, right?
yeah.
Like it doesn't matter the order, right? You can pass it in. You can pass in has SBOM first. You can pass in its dependencies, but then the assembler is going to ingest packages first. It's going to ingest artifacts, the nouns and then the verbs after that in order as it needs to. So there doesn't need to be any kind of order here.
Yeah, I'm just thinking like if we do add something in the future, which also has a nested thing, that we have to be a bit careful. But I think it's okay for now. Oh, if someone writes an ingester that ingests multiple S bombs, although I don't think we're having that issue. Okay.
So where does it code drift are you talking about here?
Okay, yeah, so the code drift I was talking about is not related to this. Code drift that I'm talking about would be related to, let's say we have to ingest the parser, right? So Like, did they be run like pulse ice and scan here? All right. And then this one has a certifier. I think the OSV one has a certifier as well. The collector is like a little bit different. So I think my question here was like, I don't think we. I'm not sure whether we want to reuse the collector here.
So I had to rebase some of the certifier code in order for it to be reused here. So it wasn't like a
Okay.
straightforward thing. Yeah. So I created that evaluate OS response, and yeah. So
Okay.
because yeah,
Yep.
initially, yeah, because I was like, I don't want to re, you know, there's a lot of code we use everywhere. So I was like, okay, let's keep everything together. So I rebased it to get it to work.
Okay. So I think what would so there will be like some level of like difference because
There will be,
the
yes. Yeah.
okay.
Well, actually, well, I mean, in the collector's case, right? The depth.dev one is all it's taking is, you know, the pearls basically, which are same thing that this one's giving you. It's just giving you pearls, right? And then that's the starting point for the depth.dev collector. So shouldn't be too bad, right? Because you just
Yeah, it
pass it.
shouldn't be too bad. It's just like it would, I guess you would translate it to the JSON and then evaluate the JSON from here.
Yeah, so if you look at, if you look down, I call the I call a parse. I call the vuln parser here also, right? So I specify like, okay,
Okay.
I call the existing parser, and I parse here at the same time, and then I
Okay,
create the
gotcha.
predicates. Yeah, and I create the predicates and pass it along. So it's the yeah, it's not re it's reusing all the code basically. So it's so you don't want to so basically the same thing. It's like yeah, you get the responses back, you get the objects back, right?
Okay.
The blobs, I guess, in this case, or whatever it is, and then you just pass it to the parser like normal.
Gotcha. Okay,
That's,
so
yeah.
that means I would basically just we want to refactor the depth of dev collector stuff to do something
Yeah, I think
similar.
some it might not be, it shouldn't be crazy refactoring, right? It is taking a parl at the end of the day as an input, but it's just coming from the data source, right? The collector subscriber data source. I think that's the input for it, so that might have to change a little bit.
What do we want our so do we want to do the caching as well from the adjuster?
Yeah, so I mean, you know, we on Slack you were chatting about this.
Yeah.
You can't keep state in the ingester.
I don't think we want to.
Yeah, exactly. Or was never the intention, right? The intention for the ingester was like you can scale it out if you want to ingest multiple things. Right. So it's like
Yeah. And
it
also
doesn't
like,
make sense.
I was worried about like the SVOM ingestion stuff, which I think that's what I wanted to get some input on is like, do we wanna skip the SVOM part and just do scorecards and source information? Because this isn't just doing it on the top level software. It's doing it for every third party package that it's seeing, right? Which I guess is what the collector is also doing, but. I don't know, it sounds like it will bloat up the ingestion time significantly.
Yes, 100%. Yeah, it's gonna. So then this is not a viable solution then, I think. On ingestion depth.dev.
Unless we don't want to do like I guess two things, right? One of them is like if we just do the scorecard information and the
I
app
mean,
source information, which we have a flag for in the collector, right?
we get hash source also coming in from clearly defined now. Scorecard we have a certifier for. So then we're kind of like the main purpose of depth.dev is like a, it's a dependency graph stuff like, you know, so it's like do we
I mean,
are
then do we
we
just want the scorecard information? I don't think that the scorecard certifier does it It doesn't just do a lookup, right? It actually runs this call card.
There was a PR that's open, I think, that will use the API or run it, I think, which we never merged yet on it. Yeah, including the scorecard API. I think he never resolved some of the comments, but I think this one looks at the API first, and then if it can't find it, then it runs it.
Okay, it's like we don't want to run it at all, right? We just want to just see what it's
Yeah, so maybe this one's just this may I forget the purpose of this PR. I haven't looked at it in a while, so I believe it might just look at the API and not actually run it.
that's not helpful. Well, this one, right?
I think on ingestion is not going to like it. I think we lose the whole purpose of depth.dev, I think, on ingestion because this doesn't work.
So do you just want to do scroll cards then?
No, like I wonder if we can like what if we do something similar to instead of I think we drop the collector subscriber. Could we introduce another pub sub or something?
Well, I guess the question is like, while we are we using the depth of dev?
I mean, like I said, I think we're using it in patch planning.
Okay.
It comes up in, I mean, we're not filtering it at this point. Like it comes up in patch planning for sure. I mean, it doesn't come up in vulnerabilities and stuff like that. But yeah, mostly patch planning, I think, comes up. But again, it's how reliable that information is, how accurate, I guess, part of the deployment is not. So I don't know. I mean, the real issue is this a collector subscriber, right? So if there, if we could replace a collector subscriber with some other piece, like I don't know, like yeah, because some come up some kind of a pub sub or something that's just taking this information, passing it from ingestion, passing it to the collector, and removing duplicates if possible. Or currently, I mean, currently the depth.dev collector actually is the one that's removing duplicates because it's keeping track of what it's seen. So it doesn't even need to do that. So like if we can just have the collector or the ingester pass stuff to a queue and then the collector just reads from the queue, then we don't need the whole collector subscriber.
Yeah, I'm also wondering like I'm kind of thinking about it in the sense of like if patch planning is the only thing that is being useful, right? Do we want to do like a just in time only for the thing that I'm looking at? I'll go figure out and download these things.
So what on query, go search.
Let's say you run the patch planning CLI,
Yeah.
right? And then the patch planning
Yep.
CLI is like, okay, I'm gonna grab this and look at all its dependencies. Then I'm going to run the ingester for depth of depth on these identifiers.
Yeah, that could work also, I think. On demand query
Because
depth.dev.
I'm thinking like what we will need in terms of like 1.0 that we don't want to necessarily like build out
Yeah.
the whole like the subscriber.
Yeah, because it's gonna bloat up the. I think that might be better approaches. Like, whatever information you need, you go query quickly. Because the depth.dev returns pretty quickly. It's not that slow. It's gonna add some query time for sure, but.
Yeah,
Marco,
I
what's
think
up?
you just save available.
How does the clearly defined get the source information, and it does it have that for does it have good coverage over that?
I mean, I'm sure it's not as good as depth.dev. So that's why I mean I would keep depth.dev for the I would keep it for scorecard, at source add and dependencies, whatever we're getting now. But yeah, it has its own, database that when you query for a parole or coordinate in the clearly defined case, it returns you a source location also about where it came from. And then you can query the source location to see if what the source repo itself, what license is associated with that source. So both those two kind of different queries are happening behind the scenes. So that's how the hash source set comes to be. It's like, okay, I know the source. Then if the source comes back, we create a hash source set, and then I also query source for the license, and then we attach and create a certify a legal with the source subject.
Sure. Yeah, because I think there is some capabilities there that Dubsev has that clearly defined won't. Like Dubsev will say how they got the link, the hash source set link. If it's just by reading a manifest file, or if it's through like salsa provenance created by
I
npm.
see.
And I think I made an issue for this, but I think that's at least a somewhat important capability, because I don't know how reliable just reading the manifest files is.
Yeah, what about at query time then? So if a query is asking for it, if they want, and maybe it's like a flag or something, use devs.dev, for example. And then at query time, you go expand out whatever you need to expand out, right? Let's say it's asking for source related stuff, then you can use devs.dev and just make it a flag. It's going to add some time right to the query, but then this way you're not ingesting any extra information to the graph until you actually need it and bloating it up.
For some queries that like aggregation queries over your entire data set,
That's going to be bad. Yes.
that would be bad,
I guess that's a question, right? Like, is that a use case for these things to be done? I think eventually, yes, right? Because I feel like you want to say a new issue came up, and depth of dev said that this was a dependency of that. Now, again, like that, maybe we will end up with a policy to say, like, don't necessarily trust depth of dev 100%.
So that's what I mean. Like, will there ever be a case where you're aggregating over your entire set, and then for depth.dev, like, are you going to rely on it? Like you said, like, is it trustworthy enough, or like, it's giving you some kind of a fuzzy answer. So
Which
it's like,
I think, like what you said, like the patch planning stuff, I think definitely makes sense, right? Like,
yeah.
it's
I mean,
like I want
otherwise,
to add information to
yeah.
the
In
structure.
every other query, we're ignoring depth.dev.
Okay.
So like for like vulnerabilities, like if depth.dev is there, we're like, skip depth.dev. So it's like, we're skipping depth.dev and everything except for when you want to use it. So that's what I'm saying. I never see the user going me like, hey, here's an aggregated query, use depth.dev with it. Like, because it's not really going to buy them anything. You rather use it on your own data rather than some kind of a fuzzy matching from devs.dev. I think it should be more of a specific, like, hey, a patch planning or some kind of specific query that's like, yeah, use devs.dev to fill in the blanks. But it would never be in like a large scale aggregation.
Gotcha.
So that's probably the better approach then. It's like, okay, we drop depth.dev or the collector subscriber, and then the collector subscriber just runs. How would that work, I guess? I guess you don't even need a collector anymore then.
Well, you run the one-time collector, right, on the client side. I mean, this assumes that you have a like almost like a privileged client that can ingest stuff as well.
I mean, we probably want to decouple those still. I think you just, yeah, see.
If not, you need an endpoint to say I want to collect this thing, which ends up being the collect subscriber, right?
Yeah, exactly.
But like I think the question is like for 1.0, like that's good enough there, right?
I think that it was my understanding that moving these things to do it on ingestion was sort of a compromise to make to temporarily fix the problems of the collector subscriber, because doing this means that the data you get there you're assuming won't change in the future, even if it will, like scorecards will change. And I'm sure we'll run into more cases of this in the future. The collectors will need to pull in data that changes and update it.
It sounds like the user flow, I think we've agreed upon with or without the collector subscriber. Is that true? Oh, not
Which
necessarily.
one?
Like, I guess let's say we implemented collector subscriber, right? We want every single depth of every package should be collected by depth of depth anyway.
No.
Okay, so then the flow of the collector subscriber would be that either you have a stream of things where it's like, oh, I'm just augmenting my graph, right? So this will be maybe the ELL stuff and things like that. And then you would also have a set of like on-demand ingestion. That comes from a client.
But how would the on-demand ingestion work? That's the problem.
I would assume that there's an API that you have to call, and then you will get events to say like this job is done. And like today we can hack around it by like directly ingesting although it requires a privileged user to run the patch planning until we create that API, the collect sub API. The alternative approach is we have like a transient graph that you would federate against. Right, so you have GraphQL, imagine GraphQL thing where you have multiple backends. Your on-demand graph you would generate at runtime, and then you will query across these two graphs.
How do you do that? Is GraphQL? I mean, I know it's capable of doing it, but we haven't done it before.
Yeah, I don't like I didn't conceptually, right? You're just like I have
Conceptually, yeah.
two graphs. I want to query across it, like writing it is a totally different totally different ball game. But
Yeah, I know we talked about this. We've never actually done it. So it's like,
I guess that's the question, right? Like it's like philosophically like
I mean, I think that would be the best solution. It's like you have the depth.dev, you use the data, because like Marco was saying, it's like data is going to get updated, right? It's going to get stale. So if you can have it in a transitive, this graph that exists for the query only, then you toss it away, and then the next time you query again, goes back to the depth.dev, it gets new information if there is anything new, and does it again, kind of thing.
So
I
I
think
guess
that would be, yeah.
the question is like, do we see that as like I'm gonna form another graph, I'm gonna put it together, or do we see that as I'm just going to augment a graph, our current graph, with a little bit more additional information. And then, you know, it will have the necessary things to dump out stuff whenever that information is no longer relevant.
How is it going to dump it? We don't have a delete mechanism yet.
Oh, we're talking about that, right?
Yeah, so if, I mean, we can delete has SBOMs, then yes, right? Like after a week, go delete all the stuff that came from nups.dev, sure. We could do it that way. But then, I mean, we still, I think we still run into the issue of like, yeah, I mean, like for now, I think it's fine. Doing patch planning, you do ingestion. But I think we would want to keep it separate, right? Like we don't want to somehow, you know, like, I don't know, like during the patch planning, it throws it into a pub sub queue or something, and then it gets ingested via the ingestion mechanism. And then the query continues forward, but then it has to know when the, you know, the ingestion completes so that it can query the database again, I guess. So it makes it very complicated.
Yeah, it's fundamentally two different models. So I think that's a decision that we have to think about a bit more.
Yeah.
Basically, what we're saying is you're pulling out the backend into the client, right?
Exactly. Okay, that's not the greatest thing. I mean, I do like the approach. I mean, like, you know, like we're not using depth.dev. Collecting it for everything is kind of pointless, and we're, you know, hitting depth.dev unnecessarily, and we're crowding our graph unnecessarily. Why not only ingest information for packages from depth.dev that the user wants to query for? If they don't want to query it, then just don't include it. I like that approach. I think we just need a cleaner way of actually doing that, implementing it, I guess.
Yeah. Okay, so we have to talk about like the longer term, how we want to resolve things like that. I don't think this will probably be one of many situations where we want to pull in data on demand. Let me write this down. Okay, someone's writing it down already, so thank you.
Yeah, I collected it at least.
Okay.
Is there anything more we want?
So I just want to make sure we at least like the short term answer. We agree we don't want the S forms downloaded during ingestion time, right? From depth of dev. Scorecard is what do we think about scorecard? Like, so use case of people want to know about scorecard stuff. It's interesting.
Yeah, I mean, during that CNCF web, you know, the web thing we did, scorecard came up a lot actually.
Okay.
So they're like, oh, how do I know if the repo is good? How do I know if it's being maintained? And how do I know if I can trust it? It's like, well, that's what scorecard's for. So
we have scorecard as another like scan scorecard on ingestion.
Yeah, we could.
The tricky thing is it would be pulls though. It would be so either, I think there are two ways to implement this, right? Either query depth so dev or just like the scorecard and the source information.
Yeah. Okay.
The other alternative is that we will say if you want scorecard information, you have to enable clearly defined. And do that.
I think that's fine. I think if on depth.dev, just query scorecard, which will give you, I mean, you know, it gives you has source set and it gives you scorecard at the same time, which should be a relatively quick query.
Okay.
So maybe we do that on ingestion. Sure. I think that's fine. And then, because yeah, I think that would be useful. But then, yeah, the dependency graph for all the packages is I don't think it's very useful until a user is like, I want that or I need it for something.
Okay. So I think the short-term answer is that I'll continue with the depth of depth on ingestion implementation, but just for scorecards and sauce. That's all set.
Yes. Was there anything else I was getting? I think that's it, right?
I think that's it. And then we just were talking about how we will enable patch planning, which was the reason why
Right.
we went into that rabbit hole.
Yeah, scorecard and yep, that's it. Okay. Yeah. Yeah, so basically we lose the capability of patch planning with depth-step information.
Yeah.
But then I would rather have it be an on-demand kind of thing, like we talked about, but like I don't know, a good way to do it though. I'll have to think about that. Because otherwise we're just bloating up the graph unnecessarily. Data we're not using.
Yeah, you basically have to run like patch plan twice, right? You get all the identifiers and then ingest up the dev and then run it again.
Yeah, you would have to like initialize it somehow and then run it again. But how do you know when it's ready to run again? It's like,
Does our current collectors assume it's synchronous, right? Like the current GraphQL ingestion is synchronous, so it will wait until it's completed, right? With it?
what would wait?
Would the GraphQL only return once it's completed ingestion?
Return a response or return a
Return a
query, you mean?
response.
From what? From the query for or from the ingestion?
Or ingestion.
Yeah, I mean, you would know when the ingestion completes.
Okay, then that's fine, right? Then we just block on the execution of like
But
the.
then it has to be done. Like, you know, how it's done currently, the collector just sends out something to the pub sub, and then it's the ingester ingests it. So the collector won't know when it's done. I'm trying to say the ingester
Gotcha.
is going to finish it and then the collector won't know. That's the issue. It's like the collector doesn't care if it got ingested or not, right? All the collector cares about is I sent the data over. My job is done. So that's what I'm saying. The query would be like, okay, then how do I know when it's the right time to query again? That's the issue kind of thing
Yeah, I mean
on some of that stuff.
you could query for as a response for the particular package and see whether you get anything back from depth of dev, which
So you'd have two separate queries then. You guess one is like initialize the patch planning, and a second one is like actually call it. And if the SBOM is has SBOM nodes are there, then complete the query. Otherwise, just tell the user to wait. Depth.dev is still completing.
yeah, or like give up at some point and say like this is like.
Or keep trying until it returns you something, you're saying? Yeah.
Yeah. It's so a current pops up. Does it have a priority? Or it's just like sequential.
The pub sub currently throws everything into one queue.
Okay.
You could break it out if you wanted to, and prioritize ingestion, SBOM ingestion over collector ingestion if you wanted to.
Yeah, we could just run to ingest
Yeah,
this also.
exactly.
Yeah.
So that's the whole point of the ingesters, like you can just scale them out. Right, if you wanted to.
Yeah. I mean, also as
I think that's
a
fine. I mean, I think,
as a hack
yeah.
we could as a hack we could
That's
we
fine.
could
I think maybe we should do it that way for now.
well I yeah I was actually thinking simpler where like we do the talk to GraphQL directly hack since we're letting a client ingest anyway. Then in that case we get direct synchronous. And then we don't have to build out all this infrastructure to propagate status.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, I think there might be just an easier approach as well. If we do this change, like i.e. not getting the graph from dev.dev on ingestion, then effectively we're putting patch planning into that bucket of guac features that work, but we're not saying are like production ready for V1. So and that bucket includes the collectors that use the collect subscribe. So we can just say, if you want patch planning, then like you need to run all these features in the bucket. So you need to run a collector subscriber. And then patch planning will work. As opposed to like coming up with another way to do patch planning without the collector subscriber, but that also isn't going to be ready for V1.
I
Does that
actually
make
like the
sense?
framing. Yeah, the patch planning not be all limited patch
Because
planning for V1.
that's what we're saying here. It won't be V1, and you're gonna have to do like more work for it. I mean, it already works. It exists. It's just in this bucket of features that we're not putting into V1 specifically.
I think I like that framing for the V1. Just saying, like the patch planning, well, advanced patch planning is not like you can just still do patch planning on your regular cluster, but advanced patch planning is a experiment, well, alpha feature where you have to.
I mean, that's even if they want to use the dev.dev information, right? Users may not trust it. Like, I don't want that. I don't want to use it anyways. Like, that's fine. So I'd rather use my own data, right? Like it could be like a company's like, yeah, I don't want my public pearls or something scanned, right? Or something,
That's true.
or sent out to the internet. So like, don't use it anyways.
So I guess I'll be okay with the decision that advanced patch planning is not V1. Though how we want to get people to use patch planning, not V1, is a discussion that we have to have, and then yeah, because I think there are multiple approaches for that, right?
Yeah, I like the on-demand one for sure. But yeah, we can talk about that after. But yeah, because I'm looking at the demos right now, like query known and unknown, hash source that and score card are one of the main things that come out of that one. So we'll still have that capability. Vulnerabilities does not take into account depend dev.dev. Reacting to supply chain incidents, which is certified bad stuff. Again, we can certify sources, which we'll get. And then you can, be doing on packages, but if it's like other packages, we don't care about it. And then, yeah.
Okay, you had another one. Is there enough time to talk through that?
Okay, 7 minutes. Oh yeah, it's just, this one is like, I think we kind of chatted about this before. It's like, like ingestion, GraphQL works great, but then querying is very limited. How do we want to get around some of this? Like, do we create a REST API that directly queries the Postgres or like some of this kind of stuff? Like, how do we get around it? Instead of us having to create, endpoints, GraphQL endpoints, like for each custom query we want.
I like that. I find that whole process of like, oh, every time we need to add an operator of like starts of it or like or something like that, we have to create something new. I agree. And now that we've kind of made the decision of like saying that we're only gonna support one backend, we don't necessarily have to worry too much about having everything the query interface go through RFEL.
Right.
Yeah.
So should it be a REST endpoint then or something? Like how do we go about it? I mean, we have to expose the backend somehow.
Yeah, I thought we'd discussed this a bit last time as well, how there are risks to, like, there are trade-offs, I guess, just directly exposing the backend data store for first class access.
Yeah, I think our discussion, if I remember what Marco was mentioning, I think our discussion last time we kind of landed with, we'll have a bunch of the stuff that is stable, we hid them behind the REST API. For everything else, like if you wanna be adventurous and query the database yourself and live and hit, you know, you can do that. And then but if you wanted to actually have this thing be supported, then you would have to create a feature request for REST API.
So how does the REST, so let's say I want to create a custom query, you know, like example I gave there, you know, give me all the SBOMs that are not in depth.dev, for example, right? Give me everything else. Then how would the query go? Because you would call the backend, won't you?
Yeah, so someone will write a SQL. I would just write a SQL statement that gets a result. And then
that hits the backend?
Yeah, just like directly query to Postgres.
Directly query to Postgres. We have the REST. I see.
Yeah. Okay. And like once it becomes a REST API that's like supported, then like we have to figure out every time we change the schema, it has to support that function.
Yes, right. Yeah. I see. Okay. So bypass GraphQL entirely and just query the SQL. Okay. Yeah, that makes sense. We don't have to give them direct access to the backend, right?
Yeah.
Like any arbitrary query, I think, yeah, that's very dangerous. I agree. We don't want that to happen. So maybe just REST endpoints a query.
Yeah.
With a specific SQL already behind it. Okay.
Anyone that's dangerous doable. Enough with the code base can go look at the SQL, but like
but then they can't modify it, right? Because you have to go through us, like a PR, to go modify it. So at least we'll be a gatekeeper. Yeah, it's got to make sure that nobody writes a SQL query that does something crazy.
Yeah, we just have to be careful when we approve support requests for REST APIs.
Right, exactly.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I think that's... Is there anything I need to do for that? On the REST API side? Or is that already kind of good to go? Because we should be able to use... I mean, like we can... If we want to query Ent, or we can use Ent query also. We could just call the address and then connect to it.
That should be... Yeah, I think I set that up already.
Yeah. Did you? Okay. Yeah. Cool.
And for what it's worth, there's like the Ent client, I think that it has, we set it to be like read only.
I see. Cool.
Yeah. It's just to like probably as far as the release process we can also or the make file, we can dump out the schema and just put it somewhere.
As part of the release, okay.
Then someone can import it into their own Explorer thing. And then I think it's going to be easier for us also to do stuff. And there's a lot of tools to support that, so I'm not too worried about that.
Yep. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Sounds good.
Yeah, I think let's have the community meeting and let's communicate that decision first, and then we can kind of have a fun deletion session on some queries.
Yeah, I mean, I think on-demand devs.dev would greatly reduce the number of data that's in our graph, greatly, because that's the majority of the bloat is coming from that,
right? Then maybe we don't need the deletion stuff anymore, right?
I mean, we still need it for like, you can probably deprioritize it a little bit lower than like, it's like, yeah, because certified phones and legal are the main ones, and then yeah, and then source set and source and stuff like that would still probably get created. I mean, we still need it, but there'd be less data overall because now, you know, that's even clearly defined is not clearly defined, or OSV is not scanning the devs.dev data.
Oh, goodbye. Yeah.
Because right now it just gets packages from the graph, right? It doesn't know where it came from. It's not filtering on devs.dev. Maybe it should, but
yeah.
But if we remove it completely, then it doesn't need to.
You had a question on filtering out. Okay, that was a graph, just like purely GraphQL stuff, right? Because we do have the information within the graph. Cool.
Yeah, so like GraphQL, we can't do a not in query, for example.
Yeah.
You know, which is kind of really annoying. It's like we can. I mean, we have to go implement it everywhere. So it's like, you know, if we can just have the int, like int backend is like you can just, you know, use SQL or whatever and do it easily instead of implementing it everywhere in GraphQL. It's like,
yeah. Sounds good. All right, we're out of time, Reggie. But I think this was a productive discussion.
Yep, that sounds good. Okay.
All right. Cool. All right.
Bye. Bye.